So I'd like to, since we're talking about the imagination, I'd like to start off with an image. And it's one of my favorite kinds of visual experiences, which is the way that distant landscapes look at dusk. And it's kind of remarkable, I mean, how often one sees these sort of natural phenomena like sunsets, moon glows, and yet they still, however, you know, till the end of our lives, they strike us with this remarkable potency and power. And there's something particular about the landscape, the distant landscape of dusk, the air of glamour, of enchantment, a kind of fairy quality that these places have. And the last time I noticed this, I was sort of staring and I had this kind of little glimpse of a perception, which is that, you know, I see that magical land and I know that if I walk to it, if I go and actually try to realize that enchantment, it will dissipate. Because of course I'll just wind up in another place that's more or less like the place I just was, maybe lovely in some ways, but that air of enchantment that the distance and the dusk lent it would dissipate with greater clarity as I actually enter into the landscape. So in some ways it becomes disenchanted with my own experience of it, my own desire to grab it or to actually immerse myself in it. But in other ways, it simply reproduces itself because as I stand in that new site and look again at a further vision, I once again encounter that same quality of enchantment that's always held at one remove. And this image for me is a very rich way into the topic of the imagination, which I'm going to be approaching from a number of different angles. And I'm going to leave the term intentionally ambiguous for the moment, because we all sort of have an idea of what the imagination is. It's a complex term, has a lot of ambiguity, a lot of different meanings. And in our modern world, a lot of those meanings are kind of a little weak. You know, you can say, oh, it was just your imagination, or it really functions on a fairly simplistic level. And at the same time, we have these sort of grandiose ideas of the imagination in a kind of artistic or creative function, where we say, oh, they have a great imagination because they're able to make up stories, they're able to create incredible visions, incredible works of art. But I would like to suggest that it behooves us to intensify our sense of the imagination, to make it even more remarkable. And one of the ways of doing that is to link it up with deeper, stronger kinds of experiences. Because the imagination as a visionary faculty leads us into, again, deeper and stronger issues of religious experience, theophonic experience, the imaginal realms, the realms of dream, of fantasy, of hallucinogenic experience, of shamanic experience. And what I want to suggest is that there's kind of a continuity of these terms, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. But I wanted to give a couple more examples of this more active sense of the imagination that really intrigues me. I came here to London to speak at the Equinox Festival, which was a gathering of occultists. And the occult is a very fascinating, the Western magical tradition is a very fascinating one, partly because of the way that it embraces the active use, the intentional and intense use of the imagination as a tool and as a gesture towards sacred realities and the higher potentials of the self. One sort of, you know, example of a magical practice that follows along these lines is the sort of conscious creation of an imaginal world that one then sorts inhabits. And rather than going into talking about the invocation of God forms and a variety of the conscious constructions of imaginative dimensions that are then interacted with through rituals or through internal processes, I thought I'd use a really easy example that most people are going to be very familiar with, which are the chakras and the role of the chakras in yogic meditation and in yoga itself. So I use these because we all pretty much have an idea popping up in our head of what the chakras are. We have these centers, you know, in our body, and they are often associated with different colors, and the deeper you go into the arcana, they get associated with particular images, numbers of lotus flowers, et cetera, et cetera. Now, right off from the get-go, you got to say that the maps of the chakras of the Hindu and Buddhist tantric constructions of the human body on an etheric or esoteric level, that these maps are not identical. Right off the bat, we're learning something about the imaginal, that it is not consistent. The most obvious example is that in Hindu Tantra, although there are different numbers of chakras and different associations, we find that there are largely seven. In esoteric Buddhist tantric practice from especially from Tibet, they tend to have five, and they sort of lump the lower three into a single center. So right off the bat, we recognize that there's a sort of openness of the imagination. But what's really important is the way that these ideas interact with experience or interact with practices, particularly practices of the body, which are very easy for us to grab a hold of and a little bit less arcane than some of the practices of Western magic, since we all sort of have an idea of what you're doing in a yogic practice, whether you're actually doing hatha yoga or doing sort of internal meditations within which you allow or construct or project, there's a lot of different words, channel, these sorts of images. And what happens, at least for most people, is that they might, let's say, they start taking yoga, they don't have any idea about etheric or esoteric bodies, they just want to like do a practice, seems to balance them, seems good for their body, good for their soul. And they go, okay, what's this chakra thing? All right, well, maybe there is a sort of center of energy that's glowing in my heart. Maybe there is a sort of point of energetic focus on my third eye or my throat. And that as the deepening experience of meditation or yoga proceeds, the fact that there's an imaginal map that's interacting with these more physical or physiological experiences intensifies the whole process. And after a certain point, you're like, oh, I know exactly what that is. I know exactly what it feels like to have my heart open or my throat be blocked. I know what that feels like energetically. I'd like to submit that that knowledge is not the same thing of knowing what it's like to have your arm cut. It's a different kind of knowledge. It's a different kind of imagination. But it points us right away to the way that the imagination doesn't just sit there as kind of like an abstract map, but that it interacts with our experience, and that in that interaction, it unfolds, it intensifies, it clarifies itself. The other example that I wanted to start out talking about was a really remarkable experience or set of experiences that I had over the last 6 months or so with a friend of mine. And she discovered a couple years ago that she had a facility that, to use a word that I don't necessarily want, that has associations that I'm not necessarily interested in, and I'll explain why in a minute, her experiences were rather clairvoyant. She didn't have a lot of background or desire or intention in the occult sphere. She had seen a clairvoyant once, knew a little bit about New Age stuff, but was not interested in occultism, was not interested in esoteric practice, knew next to nothing about the Western mysteries. And yet she found that she started to interact with this world, and I got to sort of be her scribe. So it's like it was a remarkable experience of watching somebody who has an unusual facility at experiencing a series of visionary, imagistic, quasi-shamanic landscapes and beings unfold inside her imagination with a proper sort of ritual intention. And yet she had very little sort of practice in it. So it was all very fresh. It was all very new. And you could see the way that the ideas about what that experience was influenced the experience itself, about the way that the maps and the constructs with which one brought to that sort of unfolded. And I just want to talk about a few things that were pretty interesting. A lot of it was the sort of metamorphic nature, which you're sort of familiar with from dreams, the way that certain images would carry through, or certain forms would carry through, so that you'd have like a droplet of water turning into the eye of a feather, which becomes a human eye, and then an acorn, and then a leaf, and the leaf becomes a peacock feather, and within the eye of the peacock feather is suddenly a myriad of other eyes. So you find this kind of language of this slippery metamorphic language of form and image. As the forms change, different images kind of adhere to it, and we can see this in our own dream life, and certainly in psychedelic experience. Some of the images, a lot of the images that came up, actually had a tremendous amount of archetypal or esoteric power. And as somebody who knows a lot about esoteric, images and iconology, it was actually rather remarkable because some of the images she saw, she didn't really know what their full resonance were based on the kind of exposure to the stuff that she had, a little bit of it. But one example was that at one point, she asked one of these beings what would be a good sort of protection symbol or something, and she saw these, you know, a snake and then two snakes going up a column, a pillar, and she's like, oh yeah, it's like that medical symbol, you know, that medical symbol. And you know, of course, it's a caduceus, it's associated with Hermes, with psychopomp. It's a very good thing to have as a protection symbol. So it was interesting because there seemed to be this sort of deeper archetypal dimension to some of the images that would come up. So it's sort of an interesting exposure. Sometimes the images would actually sort of make cosmic claims through the imagery. There was a very interesting one where a star became this spinning wheel that became like a roulette wheel, and you know from the movies the way that you see the spinning roulette wheel and then it slows down and you can see the numbers. And so in the vision, it's like it slowed down and you could see the numbers, but when it was moving fast, you couldn't see the numbers. And this is a very good imagistic expression of some fundamental ideas about the esoteric ideas or occult ideas about what constructs our reality. That if you dig deep enough, you find number, you find word, you know, whether it's Kabbalistic or other systems, and you get down to it, you find actual units of sense, but that in the blur of reality, they become they become a kind of film, a kind of flicker, where we're caught up in the surface level of reality. But perhaps the most interesting aspect of these images was the way that they would deconstruct themselves, the way that they would pull against their own seeming reality. So there would be some magnificent image of a queen or this sort of talking monkey or some great strong image, the kind that you would remember if you had dreamt in the morning, like, wow, I saw this thing. And then they would become automata and sort of show that they were these sort of not really there, that they were machinic, that they were something kind of false about them. And there was often this gesture towards the falseness of the perception of a particular image. There was another point at which she encountered a snake that was spinning and turning, and that each time it almost became another image. But as soon as it almost became another image, it would start spinning again, as if to say that the images that you see, the images that come up, are not really what's going on here. And this is something I think that's extremely important about this realm that a lot of people who would voyage into it miss right off the bat, is that it is as false as it is true, and that is constantly undermining itself, and that this slipperiness, this liminality, this constant transformation is part of the essence, part of the practice, and part of the wisdom of this dimension of the imagination. Now, I think we can see this even in the way that we try to understand what the imagination is, because I could use the word imagination, but I could also talk about reverie or fantasy or hallucination or daydream, apparition, specter, phantasm, vision, visualization, shamanic seeing, seership, revelation, theophany. All of these words, the distinctions are important. They're crucial. They're crucial to the history of religion. They're crucial to psychology. They're valid. But every distinction you make, I would assert, begins to fall apart. It begins to melt, because the nature of the space itself is to undermine clear distinctions. And that when you try to draw a line between merely internal fantasy and external hallucination, things get a little bit loose. And then in fact, people who go into these realms with open eyes, practicing in all the variety of ways, magical practice or psychedelics or internal visualization, all of the ways that people go into this realm, they begin to discover that these edges don't really exist. You know, is it there? Is it not there? There's a fundamental ambiguity, a fundamental ambivalence about this imaginal realm that I think is extremely important to keep in mind. The other figure that I like particularly to talk about in this sense, rather than the sort of lofty and somewhat vague term, the imagination, is the much more concrete sense of the phantasm. And it's probably just because I like the word. But the word itself also conceals one of these ambiguities or ambivalences, because fantasy and phantasm have the same root, and in some languages you could translate the word. Like if you're translating from French, you can translate the same word into either fantasy or phantasm. But if I say that word to you, there's quite a distinct set of associations. Fantasy tends to be mere fantasy. At best, it's a genre of literature or a way of just sort of, you know, idling away your time with your internal imagery. Whereas the phantasm has a much more potent sense to it. It's associated with ghosts and with specters, with hallucinations or things that you might actually see it with your eyes open in a particular space. It has a kind of haunting, enigmatic entity-like quality to it in a way that fantasy does not. So I like this image of the phantasm because it conceals this ambiguity in its own nature. And what I would sort of suggest is that the phantasm are the being or the entities that inhabit this imaginal realm or inhabit the imagination. It points to the most peculiar and remarkable and sort of enigmatic dimension of imaginative experience, which is the nature and character of the entities that one encounters, or what seem like entities, the spirits, the spirit guides, the forces, the gods, the talking animals in your dreams, the nature of what those things are. So the phantasm crisscrosses all the ways we try to organize this very wild space, because in a lot of ways, that's what makes the imagination, is its wildness. You know, you can see this ambiguity even in one of the kind of classic definitions of the imagination. If you go back and you look at Coleridge, who you know, not only was a great writer who drew very deeply from the sorts of imagery and genre that we associate with fantasy in the sense of kind of a magical world or a supernatural world, this romantic space that's kind of overlaps the Gothic, and that even himself had this sort of visionary experience. We all know some version of the story of the writing of Kubla Khan and this vision that he had that he channeled into prose, and then the vision gets interrupted before he finishes the poem. So he had a real experience of this visionary dimension. And even Coleridge makes this distinction between a primary and a secondary imagination, which points to some of the reason that I think this is such an important element. The secondary imagination for Coleridge is largely the kind of imagination that we would think of. The imagination is that ability to take fragments of bits and pieces and kind of fuse them together and make something new out of it. It's kind of the way dreams work, where bits of the day before with some childhood book you read and some image from a movie begin to combine and something new happens. And so, you know, Coleridge saw this as sort of a way of talking about this creative, poetic, imaginative faculty. One that, however, I must say that he distinguished from fancy, and I'll talk a little bit more of that in a second. But what is the primary imagination? The primary imagination is a much more deep and philosophical idea that he drew largely from Kant. Kant had this problem. How do we know things? How can we possibly know things when it's clear that there are some basic sort of what he called transcendental functions of human consciousness that we can't get around? We can't get around time. We can't get around space. Any way that we're trying to engage with reality, we're going to come up against time, against space, against certain ways in which we process the world. So he analyzed a number of these different dimensions, and then it's like, well, okay, that's great. We can talk about the faculty for perceiving time, the faculty for perceiving space. But what draws them all together in the experience that we have right now? Because however fragmented we actually believe or know reality to be, however multiple consciousness appears to be when you look at it neurologically, it's nonetheless the case that right now we're experiencing a more or less synthetic reality, a reality in which time and space and motion and sensation and memory are all woven together into a continuous stream that we might even believe is sort of reflects the essential identity of the mind. So Coleridge calls this the primary imagination. And it's a very interesting use of it, so that he puts at the center of our human experience the word imagination, the idea of the imagination, connecting, as it were, this sort of more poetic or supernatural or mystical or dreamlike realm with our basic experience of being an I who synthesizes reality on the fly, creating our sense of a continuous reality. And this, I think, points to a one of the reasons that the imagination is such an important part and I think a kind of under-recognized or utilized part of our consciousness is that there's a continuum between this more obviously supernatural or mystical or shamanic dimension of the imagination and our experience right now. Because right now, we are in a visionary reality. Right now, we are in an imaginal construct. And you can look at it just simply from a scientific point of view. Well, I know that this is really just a bunch of, you know, weird quantum mechanical forces that are going on, and I know that there's all of these different ways of describing what's actually going on beneath the surface. And yet, however much I knock myself, however many drugs I take, go to sleep, whatever, I'm back here again. Now, because it sort of seems consistent, we think that this is sort of the reality. But it's not. It's a construct. It's a construct that our brains are making up as we go along, and it has cultural dimensions, it has historical dimensions. There's every reason to believe that somebody, that a Neolithic person, you know, standing on the same riverbank that I can go to now, would not experience it in the same way. Because the actual nature of ordinary reality shifts, because it's a bit of a construct. So, for me, this sort of opens up the deeper implications of the imagination. So I want to talk a little bit more about one of the things I think you can say about all these different factors, you know, vision, visionary experience, shamanism, the kinds of experiences that I mentioned before with the chakras and with this clairvoyant nature, is that at its root, the imagination is about mediation. It's about mediation. There's something fundamentally liminal about it. Liminal meaning between. It's an in-between environment. It's a crossing. It's a crossroads. It doesn't have a center. It doesn't have like a place from which it sits. It's always moving between different kinds of categories, experiences, levels of reality. And that part of its wisdom or part of its teaching has to do with a kind of initiation into this liminality and its fundamental ambiguity, its fundamental ambivalence. And we can sort of see this mediation even in some very original ideas about where the phantasm comes from, or original meaning classical, ancient. From both Aristotle and Plato, we can glean an image of the imagination or of the phantasm that shows and points towards this mediating function and explains in a kind of deeper way, I think, some of the dynamics that I'm talking about. So Aristotle was sitting there, and he's facing this problem, which is, how does the mind relate to the body? How does the mind, which is considered to be of another order, a different kind of thing, fundamentally relate to the world of matter? How do I understand things? How do I see things if I am of a fundamentally different nature than that picture on the table? We don't really think this way anymore, so it doesn't sort of seems like a non-problem in some ways, although in other ways it remains a very big problem. But in any case, the way the solution was to posit a part of the body, really, or a part of our constitution as being combinations of matter and spirit, called the pneuma, or the spirit. And what the pneuma did was sort of read images that came in from the physical world, create images that then we use to think and understand and perceive. So when we're thinking and understanding and perceiving and remembering, we're actually dealing with these images that he called phantasms. So the phantasm is something that arises at the interface between the external physical world and our eternal spirits. And it's through the phantasm that we think, that we understand, and that we experience psychology. It's essentially a kind of early psychological view that for later thinkers would kind of fuse this with some ideas out of Stoicism and come up with the model that indeed our whole sort of interaction with the world, our energies, our agencies, our decisions, our movements, our impulses, were all taking place inside this pneuma, this spirit that mediated between our essential rational core, intellectual core as they called it, which doesn't mean what we mean by intellectual now, but our sort of essential spiritual core, was mediated with this agency. One example of how this could be applied on a psychological level that I think we can all very much relate to is the sort of ancient malady of the amor, I don't know how to pronounce it right, heroes or heros. And this is the sort of, even though sometimes it's thought of as the amor eros of heroes, it's not really clear exactly what that term comes from. But the basic problem is when you're falling in love, when you're absolutely, obsessively, overwhelmingly infatuated. And one phenomenon that I think we can all sort of relate to is that when you're absolutely, overwhelmingly infatuated with a person, a vision, an image in your head, you see that image everywhere. You see traces of that image everywhere. You see people who look like, in my case, her. You see, it obsesses your mind, and it's in your dreams, it's in your reveries. You can't really focus on other things that are going on. And they just, you know, they have descriptions of people who are just completely taken over by this kind of obsessive, imagistic attack. And indeed, they explain it almost like a kind of vampirism, where what happens is that the phantasm enters in, this erotic phantasm that's charged with eros, which, as I'll say, show in a moment, is, you know, one of the fundamental forces of the universe. It enters into the mind and it just takes over. It's just that's it. It's there. There's no way out. And so you're essentially in being passionately, madly in love, taken over by this sort of, you know, by a phantasm. You're attacked by a phantasm. Oh wait, I lost my page number. So that's sort of an example already of how you could sort of think about the way that these things become animated and work. But there's a more sort of spiritual dimension if we sort of shift in this very superficial, but I think nonetheless hopefully still interesting way of talking about these things to a more Platonic view. And in that view, we're going to sort of expand our field, that this erotic energy that in the previous example is really linked solely to human love, we can really see it expand into the essential animating force of the cosmos. That what ties the cosmos together is this force, is eros. And that the mediating function that the pneuma had in a more sort of psychological sense in this earlier account expands to take on cosmic proportions. That it's through this a mediating force that indeed we move between a sacred or spiritual dimension and the world of matter, and that this composition sort of makes up our personalities. The scholar Ion Culiano talks about the Platonic space shuttle, and the Platonic space shuttle is his sort of lively metaphor for one version of a Platonic or really Neoplatonic cosmology, which gives you a little bit more information about the nature of this mediating pneuma, or soul as it's often translated. It's kind of confusing the way that the words get translated. The idea is that when we incarnate into human bodies, we begin from a land far away, from beyond the sphere of the fixed stars, our essential sparks of intellectual being, our essential spiritual sparks, descend. And as you probably know, the ancients saw the world as kind of like an onion with the earth at the center, and then there are these various levels above us, and that the planets, the individual planets, rule their own spheres. So Venus moves through its own sphere, Jupiter moves through its own sphere, and then you have these revolving spheres around the earth, and then finally we reach the fixed stars, and then beyond the fixed stars is the Empyrean. So as we descended in our from this high realm, we take on the soul. We take on this mediating in-between material that we sort of accrete, that becomes our space shuttle as we're hurtling towards Earth. And as we pass through all of these spheres, we are marked almost literally, like branded, or shaped, twisted a little bit as we go through each of these different spheres. And this is the source of your natal chart. This is the source of your particular astrological character. Your personality, your temperament, your inclinations, your likes and dislikes, the things that turn you on, the things that terrify you, all this material that kind of could be imagined to surround our essential and more abstract spiritual selves, are all sort of marks of this soul. They're shapes that are placed as we descend into incarnation. And this is sort of the basic kind of astrological matrix. So it's interesting that even in our contemporary world where that cosmology is utterly absurd, that if any of us who find astrology interesting, even from the point of view of a metaphor, let alone something that actually has divinatory power, you're still participating in some way with this universe. And moreover, you're participating in this universe that has something very strong to say about the imagination, that has something very strong to say about the phantasms, about this realm of spirits and gods which shape and articulate our desires and our fears. And finally, this is partly where you get a lot of the fundamental logic of magic, at least in the Western sense, because by aligning yourself with these different planetary energies, you can produce change in your personality or your psychology or your experience. So a lot of what ritual magic or higher ritual magic is about cultivating the right time, the right elements, the right metals that are associated with these different planetary beings. And so with this idea of a ritual invocation of astrological forces that you want, for example, if you're born under the sign of Saturn, you're miserable a lot of the time, it'd be really good to have some Venus and Jupiter going on. So at the right time of the year, I'm going to cultivate this energy of Venus or whatever. And what I'm not so interested in the mechanics of the magical act itself, but really the way that they provide a ritual technology of the imagination, that you're actually engaging in the way that we might see a shaman engaging a sort of culturally or mystically constructed experience of the animal spirits who inhabit their part of the world, that in this case we're having the same kind of relationship with astrological forces. A final little bit about this sort of Neoplatonic line is the way that, if you remember, I was talking about this heroic love and the way that one would become so overtaken by the image of the lover that you would almost disappear. That there were certain ways of inverting this in a more Platonic or spiritual guise, where that experience itself was seen as a portal to God, that becomes a line into God. And we know this most, or this is articulated or expressed most richly in the Sufi tradition, where the energies and the devotional passions of the beloved become a mirror and an avenue towards God. It's also very important to Dante, of course. And so you have this way that erotic energy becomes cosmic. And one additional element of Islamic mysticism that relates very much to this idea of the imagination and also this kind of experience of the beloved, the idea here is that this image, the image of the beloved, becomes so powerful and so infused with God that it becomes theophonic, meaning that it becomes an expression or a vision of God. And the idea of the theophany is extremely important to revealed religions like Islam and Judaism and Christianity, because you have a problem. You read these books and they say there's always some like magical thing that happens. The bush starts burning. Well, what's that? If I come down from the hill right now and said there was a magical bush burning and it told me to take my people across, they're like, no. That's illegitimate. Well, what about in the book? They had the burning bush in the book. What's up? It's like, no, that's a theophany. That is a genuine vision. That is a true vision. It's a vision that has, in some sense, an even higher order of truth than the kind of messed up, confusing experiences of physical world that we encounter most of the time. And this theophonic imagination it grows in certain Sufi thinkers, and particularly Ibn Arabi, at least Ibn Arabi as translated by the 20th century philosopher and historian Henri Corbin, into a very robust idea of the imagination, which Corbin called the mundus imaginalis, or the imaginal world. Now, using a different word than the imagination, because as I'm just about to talk about, anytime people start talking about true imagination, they always have to talk about false imagination. They always have to draw a distinction. So, you know, Corbin talking about Ibn Arabi, talking about the realm where theophanies happen. Where do they happen? What is the theophonic space? It's this imaginal realm that once again mediates between our experience of physical reality, confused, mortal, buffeted by desires and inclinations, and the realm of God, the sort of pure, abstract, inconceivable realm of true principles, true essences. In between, we have this realm of images. There are temples there. There are burning bushes there. There are angels there. There are beings there. But they have this powerful mediating function of standing in between a realm that's inconceivable to us and a realm that can actually mirror through through imagery, through bodies, through spaces, the nature of this imaginal realm. So I mentioned about this distinction. So I talked before about how the imagination is always slippery, that there's all these different, this is a phantasm, this is hypnagogia, this is the dream, this is imagination, this is hallucination, and then actually the closer you look at it, you realize that those boundaries are kind of false, and there's always this sort of slippery motion between them. Allied with this and the anxiety that produces, the anxiety of ambiguity, a fundamental ambiguity, is the fact that over and over again, almost in any account that you read of the space, and however it's expressed, they always, always define the difference between true and false, or good and bad, or the real deal and foolishness. And it comes up over and over again. Like there's an alchemical maxim that Jung quotes. Oh, I'm not good with Latin, so forgive me. Opus nostrum per verum imaginatium et non fantastica. So it's like there's true imagination and then there's the phantasm, the fantastic. You know, Paracelsus did the same things. True imagination and fantasy, which he called the madman's cornerstone. I thought it was pretty cool. Again, Henri Corbin, if you read him, you're like, great, the imaginal world sounds excellent. I'd love to visit. How do I know if I'm actually there? Well, how do you know? What grounds it? What grounds the true imagination? I don't think you can. And I think that awareness of not being able to is a really interesting shift in the nature of our experience of this fundamental ambiguity. Another example to draw from Western magic, since I've talked a little bit about that, is John Dee, the famous, you know, Elizabethan magician, who, using a very ancient and fairly reliable technology of producing visual hallucinations or producing imaginal unfoldings, staring into a stone which has some kinds of cracks and ambiguities, and producing just enough visual ambiguity that your mind starts creating images that can, in some minds, spill into whole sorts of dimensions, and I'll talk more about that phenomena towards the end of the talk. But anyway, they're sitting there and they're channeling, he and his pal Edward Kelly are channeling angels, but they have the same problem. If you actually read the accounts of these angelic conversations, a huge amount of the time they're going, are you who you say you are? Wait, are you really an angel? How do I know you're not a demon? How do I know that you're not simulating this appearance of an angel? But that question, which is the question of the phantasm who crisscrosses the imagination with his ambiguity, with his tricksternish, with an almost demonic quality, that's the fundamental question of the imagination. And in many ways, there's no way out. And I believe that part of our experience as moderns, part of what constitutes modernity in terms of its relationship to consciousness, in terms of its relationship to the sacred, is an increasing recognition or confrontation with this inability to resolve the nature of these images, to this profound discomfort with being able to say, that is a true vision, and that is a mere hallucination. And part of the reason for this, or where we see this reflected, is in a different kind of mediation, a different kind of mediation that interestingly kind of parallels the emergence of modernity, which we might say is whatever, you know, late Renaissance, which is the flowering of technological media, the flowering of optical devices which are used to produce Well, phantasms. So let's talk about the magic lantern. The magic lantern is basically a slide projector. You know, so you just have a light source, you put in a little painted glass image, and it projects something on the wall. The first image we have of the magic lantern is from about 1671 from a book by Kircher. And interestingly, what image do we see projected against the wall? Well, it's an image of a soul in purgatory. And in fact, when you look at the images that are projected shown in the pictures of magic lanterns in these earlier books, over and over and over again, they are images of demons and devils and spirits and angels and souls writhing in torment. Very interesting. Why is it that when we begin to simulate, because essentially these technologies are simulating the imaginal faculty, they're simulating our internal ability to see images that aren't quite there in the way that you guys are all there for me now. And that as soon as we begin to develop technology that does that, we immediately invoke the realm of the supernatural. We immediately invoke this realm of archaic, archetypal, sacred, mystical, supernatural imagery. And that, to me, captures this kind of fundamental divide or this tension that we have between recognizing that the imagination, in many ways, is a construct, or recognizing that we can't really say that any of its offerings are really real, and yet our obsession, which is, you know, as intense now as it has ever been, with at least experiencing a simulation of these supernatural realms, of these shamanic realms. Because, you know, you just watch movies all the time, you watch TV shows all the time. You know, on one level, you have nothing to do with the shamanic reality. You're not taking drugs and communing with the spirits of the earth. You're just watching, you know, Hollywood movies. And yet, if you take from another look, and you look at the material that saturate our media, you find the same stuff, the same obsession with specters, with phantasms, with supernatural entities, with angels, with devils, blah, 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 blah. It keeps coming up over and over again. And I don't believe it's simply because the stuff it's in our culture and so we're still fascinated with it, or it's simply a way to shock, it's simply a way to sort of distract people. I think that it is this imaginal realm, that it's the very nature of the phantasm that's kind of inhabited or haunting. It's a kind of act of haunting our media, because you see it all the way through. The situation with the magic lantern keeps happening and keeps happening. Through the phantasmagoria of the early 19th century, where they started to take magic lanterns and put them into kind of spectacles with smoke and ghosts, and they would have these shows in Gothic cathedrals. And they did this interesting thing where, I think, what's this, I have it written down here. Robertson, yeah, Etienne Gaspard Robertson, who was the famous French guy who did the really big phantasmagoria during the moment when the Gothic is arising and all this sort of supernatural material is more popular in popular culture, where he would mount these slide projectors on wheels so you could create animation. So you imagine that you have a screen right here, and then I have my little magic lantern here, and you know, if I have it right here and then I go back like that, you know, you're gonna get these sort of moving images. So we start to see cinema, we start to see proto-cinema through this medium of invoking these various kinds of beings. In a way that if you really look at it, if you look at that basic situation of a screen, a light, an image, a projection, a shadow, this is a fundamentally Platonic and sacred condition that we are now replicating in technology in a way that's going to go faster and faster and more intense until we have all these proto-cinematic devices, and finally we wind up at film. We wind up at cinema. And you can look at the history of cinema purely in terms of realism, but anyone who's really going to look at the history of cinema and look particularly at its psychological force, you're going to look at sex and violence and ghosts and demons and special effects, because it's special effects from the get-go. From the get-go, cinema is about producing non-narrative experiences of wonderment, bizarreness, intensity, that in their psychological experience are incredibly similar to the sorts of experiences that one would encounter in a shamanic session or in a true encounter with the true imagination. So this is part of this interesting situation we are in as moderns in relationship to the imagination, where we inherit this sort of tradition of simulating, replicating, imitating, manufacturing these phantasms that nonetheless don't go away. In fact, they become in some ways even more intense. They spill into reality in all these peculiar ways, because we can't really talk about the phantasm without actually talking about real paranormal experience, seeing ghosts, seeing UFOs, where people say, I'm a totally ordinary person and I saw the most incredible thing, it has destroyed my worldview and I'll never be the same. And if you weren't there, if you weren't in that person's head, you can never have that experience. You can never really go through that initiation, go through that existential confrontation with an imagination that is larger, more intense, more magical, and more even demonic than you would ever have imagined. And yet, if you look at the material of all of these paranormal experiences, ghosts and UFOs, etc., there's always these links to popular culture. There's always these links to the material that we produce and that we entertain ourselves with. In fact, some of these linkages are quite remarkable. The whole narratives of UFO encounters that can be found in science fiction pulps from 20 years before. So there's this strange interaction between our cultural media and the actual quality of encounter with these sort of other realms. But in doing that, we create this very interesting tension between experience and skepticism. So once again, the phantasmagoria. I'm Robertson. I'm creating these totally gothic, supernatural displays where ghosts appear and they offer, you know, revelatory experiences, and the ghosts of recently dead people show up, and it's this total spectacle of the supernatural. And at the beginning of the show, he'd say, I'll probably just read the quote because it's kind of interesting. He goes, "It is a useful spectacle for a man to discover the bizarre effects of the imagination when it combines force and disorder. I wish to speak of the terror which shadows, symbols, spells, the occult works of magic inspire. I have promised to raise the dead, and I will raise them." Which in some sense he does. If you can raise an image of somebody who has passed, like a spirit photograph, some ways you've raised the dead. But at the same time, but that his images were, quote, illusions designed as an antidote to credulity and supernaturalism. So he wanted to have it both ways. He wanted to have his cake and eat it too. He wanted to produce the phenomena, the experience of a genuine confrontation with the supernatural or with the imaginal, where you're actually, your spine shivers, you don't understand what's going on, you don't know how this effect could possibly produce, and at the same time, this is also, because it is simply constructed with media, a disenchantment of the supernatural. Ah, it's just a machine. It's the great, terrible Oz with his levers behind the curtain. And that tension is, I would say, fundamental to our current mode of dealing not just with the imagination, but with just, you know, sacred experience, with the nature of the spiritual, the nature of the deeper elements of our psychology. Terence McKenna had a great quip, and I'm winding up here, but there's a bit more. Terence McKenna had a great quip where he talked about like the way that the 20th century was the century of the moving image. And what he meant was, he goes, look at the turn of the last century, from the 19th to the 20th century. You had simultaneously the emergence of cinema, the emergence of psychoanalysis and its core analysis of dreams, and the first time in the West, and he's talking really about the West, that psychedelics begin to become objects of study. So all of these things introduce a realm of the moving image that maintains this weird ambivalence between genuine experience or intense experience or transformative experience and an underlying kind of structure or technology that you can point to. I think I'll skip talking about the role of the imagination in psychology except to just point to a really interesting and fundamental tension between the two famous figures of Jung and Freud, that the way that they related to the material of the imagination is fundamentally different in a way that really plays off this tension that I'm talking about or reflects it. For Freud, the surface material of a dream is not very important in the sense that it is simply a code for some underlying reality, and that in order to get at that reality, you had to sort of read or interpret or deconstruct the surface or manifest content of the dream. So if you saw a lion god in your dream, it wasn't about lion gods. It was some reflection of some Oedipal situation or whatever the interpretation might be. So there's this fundamental difference between the surface and the bottom. For Jung, that's not the case. That there is something essential and autonomous and self-grounding about the imagination, or what he called the active imagination, which in many ways is the most interesting part of his work, was the embrace of the active imagination, which meant how do you open up this realm and just go further into it, to see what happens, to the images. Where do the images lead you? And this partly explains their differing relationships to the sacred, because the more that you take the surface material of this imaginal experience seriously, the more it tends to open up into these archetypal or sacred or mystical kinds of experiences. And even so far that if you go to contemporary kind of post-Jungians like James Hillman, where it's all just about letting the imagination go in its full ferocious multiplicity without even attempting to make any sense of it, that even our desire to interpret our dreams is a sort of holdover of our rationalist distance from the material of the imaginal or the material of the soul. So a lot of that contemporary rhetoric about the soul comes out of this sort of way of approaching and intensifying the imagination. And finally, just to talk about the third prong of Terence's thing just a little bit, is to talk about psychedelics. That psychedelics, in a way, are almost the bridge between psychology and film. Sounds kind of silly, but what do I mean by that? Well, on the one hand, psychedelics are obviously material objects which produce experiences, produce their effects in a biological way. It has to do with the nature of our vision, the nature of our neurology, and the way the particular chemical combinations lock into particular aspects of our neurology and produce effects. There is no way that anybody making the most grandiose claims about the realities revealed by psychedelics can avoid the fact that on some level they are merely material processes. Like the way that a film, however magical the special effects, is a material process that you can point to. It's a flicker effect, it was using digital technology, blah, 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 to produce this experience that could be magical and amazing. Most of the time it's kind of cheesy, but it's often pretty cool. And in a similar way, psychedelics have this aspect of being a technology, of being a media. It's just that they arise through the molecular production of plants and the chemical laboratory. And yet, boy, do they open up interesting realms of this sort of psychological imaginal. So much so that like all of these strong examples that I've been talking about sort of can make sense or can be almost seem to be perceived. So where does that leave us? How do we deal with that? How does one deal with the content of a vision? And this is what I'm sort of pointing to, and it's really just a fundamental ambiguity. I can't resolve it. I can't say, oh, this is what it means and this is how to take a vision. What do you do with, if you're my friend who has these experiences of entities come and telling you about the nature of things? It's like, what do you do with this? What is the status of that? How do I interpret that? Because we all know people who have had visionary experiences or dreams or psychedelic experiences, and they go off the deep end because they believe them, because they become theophanies, because they become things that tell them specifically about how the world is, and now I know how the world is, and I've had a true vision, I've channeled a god, I saw a glimpse of the end of time, whatever it is, and that idea kind of vampirizes their reality because they ascribe so much belief to it. And yet, at the same time, it almost seems almost impossible to live in a world without the meanings and the juice and the life and the possibility that comes through these imaginative experiences. Whether it's something that we get through reading books or watching films, or whether it's something that we embrace on deeper levels by keeping dream journals, or taking a trip down to the to Peru, or delving into visualization. There's something about this realm and about the nature of its communications that remains in some ways not reducible to mere technology, not reducible to mere psychological forces. It calls for a certain kind of confrontation, a certain kind of initiation. It's just that the initiation, I do not believe, winds up or should wind up with a kind of coherent belief system or an understanding about what the true nature of these visions are. But at the same time, we can't really, I think it's very difficult to sort of dodge that experience, because part of what it's teaching you is about itself. This is my final point. When I remember initially at the beginning when I was talking about my friend's clairvoyant experiences, I talked about how some of the images would arise and they would kind of deconstruct themselves. So the great, beautiful vision of this sacred angel would become a toy, an automata that kind of started to become jerky and sort of point to like, look, it's not really this. It's not really this kind of image. But there's something about this realm of fantastic, marvelous, exotic, evocative images that disenchants itself, that shows you how it's mere smoke and mirrors, that there really is a guy behind the counter, and yet it doesn't end there. You can see this yourself, and this is one of I think I've talked to my friend Jeff here about this, about being aware of how you enter a dream. If you pay attention and you try to stay awake as you go to sleep, sometimes, at least in my experience, I've been able to watch the onset of dream. Similar things can happen under psychedelics. In the dream experience, I'm lying there getting dreamy and drifty, looking more or less on my closed inner eyelids, and seeing a bunch of random phosphine activity. You know, phosphines, visual system just kind of going doop, 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 doop. You know, a random starscape of meaningless neural firings. But then there's a certain pattern. Oh, there's a triangle. And something, the imagination, grabs a hold of that triangle. It's a triangle. And then the triangle becomes, oh, it's a pyramid. Oh, I'm on a landscape. Oh, it's a sandy landscape. And there's these guys who are coming at me with the, and then I'm in a dream. And it's this interface, this move between random neural static, the meaningless realm of technology, the meaningless realm of it's just smoke and mirrors. And there's this transition, this flip, this liminal space where suddenly meaning arises, suddenly resonance, suddenly archetype, suddenly encounter, entity, message, dream, wonder. And that's where we are. We're on that point. And I don't know how to resolve it. I don't think there is a resolution, at least from what I see. But I do believe that this kind of thing is an initiation, or an endlessly deepening initiation, that if done with open eyes, begins to open up the world. And with that, I think I will end. Thank you so much for your attention. It's great to be out here.
Sure. Okay, great. Thank you so much for that, Eric. That was an incredible talk. We'll open up the floor to some questions. Anybody have some? I'll take the first positive. I don't really know how to kind of address a question to that fantastic talk. You kind of left it liminal or love that it, there's a lot of room for maneuver. But I'd like to think of it, how would you position this perhaps in terms of talking about psychedelics, Huxley's idea of the perennial philosophy, that there is a kind of, there is a mystical truth there, there is a kind of a core visionary experience or mystical experience that people can have, which is collective in a sense, in its own right, and how, what is the position of that in terms of this deconstructed idea that
right.
It comes, the imagination is merely something a bit more random?
Well, I mean, I'm maybe a little disappointed that you interpreted it that way, because I was trying to walk my line a little better, but for one thing, I mean, the Huxley's idea of the perennial philosophy tends to be a little bit more philosophical, not so directly related to experience, in the sense that it's really about these core ideas that can be shared. But if you're pointing to the fact that you can point to characteristic experiences that people go through that have commonality, sure, I think that it's fundamental of this realm that it's common, that it's not merely your own experience, and that part of that passing into the imaginal is that you're passing into something that has a collective dimension, or that we can see the way that it has a collective dimension. But when it comes to saying that my experience is your experience, or that we're all here having that same kind of experience, that seems to me almost more of like a sociological reality, or a sociological construction, or an anthropological experience, that by doing that, certain things happen, and it may be that we all start to getting a kind of group mind thing going, and we all start going to the same place. But that there's also something in the nature of these experiences that pull away from that, and that you find that often people are ignoring the disharmonies that accrue to it. So that's sort of, you know, the way that I see it. I don't think that's clearly that something like that happens, and it points towards whatever dimensions of reality that are so overwhelming or so different than what we know that we're justified in loosening our beliefs about how things are. But that I think that if you pay attention to the processes that come, that it's still ultimately going to be your own personal initiation that takes you forward. Because sometimes people have experiences that they can never go back from. And once they've opened this realm, they can't step away. It doesn't mean that they've just become gaga with belief systems. And I didn't mean to imply that, if that's what came across. But that process is almost a balance of skepticism and acceptance that moves through it. And then when people lose the skeptical side, not the hard skeptical side, but the ability to deconstruct your own experiences, oftentimes delusion or certain kinds of mania lie in that way. And I'm cautious about that kind of phenomenon. That makes sense?
That's wonderful. Yeah. Can I okay. I'll start with Ben.
Yeah,
I'm quite
really
interesting.
You have to speak up. Sorry. There's two things.
Yeah, those are great questions. I think they're actually really deeply related in some ways. I think I'll start with the second one first. I think there's a really interesting effect that happens if you just, let's just talk about film, where the first time something happens, it often has remarkable transformative power. So we all know the Lumiere brothers story when they showed the train in the hall and everybody freaks out. And now that would not freak us out. And you can just see that with special effects. The first time you saw bullet time in The Matrix, for me, that was like the part of the dream where things get good, where you're dreaming and then like, whoa, and it's super crazy, and I remember it the next day, and it kind of changes how I feel in my body, and it's like a vision. And I think sometimes when those things first happen, they actually produce a phenomenal experience that is deeply similar to other experiences that you would see in dreams or psychedelics or visionary experience. Even in terms of like actually changing the way you do it, they don't probably tend to last as much, or they become, and that's probably because they're also tricks. And then the next time you see it, like, it's just a trick, doesn't work anymore, whatever. And that, so that you can see almost special effects in cinema as sort of sapping the life out of this more organic kind of visionary experience, because it's like, we can figure out how to model that thing. The first time it's like completely mind-blowing, but then unless you're actually being artful with it, it dissipates. It actually undermines it or disenchants it. A great example is in that, I don't know if they called it blueberry here, but in the States it's called, what do they call it? Shoot, I can't remember. What is it?
Renegade.
The special effects at the end of Renegade, which is done by some French company whose name I should remember, but I don't, are like ayahuasca visuals, and they are very, very good. They are disturbingly good. If you are at all familiar with those realms and you're sitting in the cinema hall, you're not gonna be the same guy, you know, a minute later after you've seen these things. They're very, very not only suggestive, but actually kind of stimulating. And then you can move into all the realm of all the sort of more abstract flicker films, which are, you know, using actual sort of abstract imagery and flicker to produce neurological experience. I mean, there's a whole history of visionary abstract animation, which is explicitly designed, again, not just to mirror, but actually stimulate or resonate with mystical or altered states. And some of them are quite powerful, even though they were made, you know, in 1953 with like little color dots or some weird early computer design. So I think there's very much authentic and meaningful trend with or line within cinema that's directly engaged with trying to actually not just simulate and sap the energy from these sorts of experiences, but actually stimulate them and kind of enhance them in a way. And now I think I've actually forgotten. Oh no, the first question was about I always thought that was a great, rich notion that yes, there's an archetypal reality. Yes, there is these sort of collective forces that, you know, if you look at people's dreams or their visionary experience, you're gonna find angels or angel-like beings all across the world. There's gonna be these flying women who are beautiful and glowing, and you're gonna see, you know, glowing eggs around people, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm not gonna say that's all cultural transmission or even just the morphology of vision. I can't make that claim. It seems like there's something deeply collective. And yet, it's also historical. It's also historical because there's many dimensions of those kinds of things, the gray alien being a perfect example, that clearly do not emerge or do not happen in the same way 1,000 years ago or 10,000 years ago. What is that? Well, one way of looking at it is that it goes a little bit farther to answer your question in a positive way. And I actually intended to emphasize this a little bit more. Was the way that we can look at the imagination, at this tricksy realm of liminality, as an interface. It's an interface. It's an interface that's constructed on the fly between us and, I don't know, the deep mind, actual agencies. In that Platonic view, remember, it's an interface between us and these higher, pure, and perfect Platonic principles. Or for Ibn Arabi, it's an interface between God and us, these images. So if we think about it, when we think about mediation, if we think about it as an interface, it kind of opens that up. So yes, the interface changes. Yes, the interface is historical. Yes, in many ways, it's constructed. And yet what's on the other side of that? What is the nature of the agency? And that's why it always comes around to the mystery of the entity, of the phantasm. Is there an other there? Is that other just my deep mind? Is it our deep mind? Is it an actual, you know, multiple dimension? So being self-conscious about the constructed nature of the imagination does not mean letting go of the possibility of higher dimensions and occult ideas and sacred ideas about the nature of reality. But to my mind, it just adds a sort of richness and complexity to that actual confrontation where we are aware of the way that it's an interface. And that's like in my friend's clairvoyance when the queen becomes an automata, it's like the realm itself is going, remember, this is just an interface. Remember, this is just an image. The image is not the thing, even though all it is images. It's an interesting tension.
Eric, if I can just say that your lecture was fascinating, but I think it's one aspect and function of the imagination you didn't touch on that's extremely important. That's the role of the imagination in healing and the emergence of the fantastic at times of personal crisis. And you talk quite a lot about film, and this is a theme that occurs quite often in films. An example that a lot of people have probably seen is Pan's Labyrinth, where the child is unable to deal with adult situations and is thrown into into fantastic realms in which he seeks to resolve the conflicts that he doesn't only partially understand and so on. And another rather mundane example you might think, I went to the supermarket the other day, and to entertain my granddaughter, I bought a copy of Hook. It reminded me never to buy another Robin Williams film. But at the same time, the story of Hook, for those who haven't seen it, is that Robin Williams is a businessman who's obsessed with his business and neglecting his family for that reason. And in fact, he's Peter Pan. His children are stolen away into Neverland, and his identity as Peter Pan is brought to him by a wise woman, in fact, interestingly enough, and he goes through the window, the doors, into this fantastic realm, and he defeats Hook and so on, and returns to his family. And his crisis, the personal crisis of his family relationships, are resolved through his acting out, if you like, in the imaginal realm. And one of the things that I think is particularly interesting about a film like that is that at an innate level we all understand this drama. People watch it, no one, only for those who are analysing it are going to say, oh, this is the meaning of it. But everybody understands that mechanism, the significance of this process. And I wondered if you'd like to
I think that's great. I think it's especially pointing to the way in which these things often arise at points of personal crisis. And then also if you look at like rites of passage, where a kind of point of crisis and transition is sort of, culturally constructed. Like at this point when you're 12, you go off in the bush and they scare the shit out of you, and then they tell you secrets about the universe. And you know, that's going to be a freaky experience. That's an imaginal experience. And that in a way formalizes the process that I think you're talking about. You know, Jung talks a lot about this, that at points in transition and points of stress that these things arise. And so from a kind of a mundane perspective, you could see them as compensatory. You know, you could look at Pan's Labyrinth and go, oh, the little girl, she's so stressed out, she's going to have this compensatory fantasy to buffer reality. Okay, that's one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at it is that as humans, we construct mundane reality really well. It's useful for us to live in quotidian reality. It's hard to engage constantly the realms that lie beyond it. But when that reality breaks down, then it's open, then we're open, then they come on in. And we can't help but engage and respond because we don't have the strength or the conviction of the basic mundane reality. It's like, I can't deal with it anymore. I'm so emotionally shattered that dream is going to obsess me for weeks. Whereas if I'm not emotionally shattered, I had an interesting dream, maybe I'll tell you about it, maybe not. But seeing that, the healing component, I think, is really important.
At least in something perhaps a little bit deeper than that in a way, at least in something a little bit deeper than that, even in something as apparently banal as Hook, you're seeing the acting out where different forces are embodied in different characters, such as Hook and so on, and that there's an actual working out, as it were, by the characters involved who are dealing with different aspects of the imagination or of the imaginary realm, and that leads all the way back to people like Hook and the imaginal realm as a whole and its significance. But part of my point is it something that's rooted in our culture? Many of us, it's there all the time.
Yeah.
And just to refer to another speaker here who said, oh, our particular culture is at war with the imagination, as it were, that reason dominates our culture. And that the imagination is totally repressed. And I sat there thinking, you know, in half an hour, thousands of people will be going to London theatres. Sitting in those theatres, entering the imaginary world. And going through dramas,
which all have
a ritual kind of content in a sense.
Very well.
And so I don't think it is true. I think that the imagination is there all the time, and it's very deep, and we're very much in contact with it. But in the way we talk about television and films.
Excellent. Yeah, good comment.
Danny?
I was just wondering. I was fascinated by what you said about the Terence McKenna quote that the 20th century was kind of the century of the moving image. And in part, I read that as film came in, it was a new technology that created a whole new set of metaphors for understanding the world that were then applied in other areas and sort of opened up a whole new set of ways of dealing with and engaging with all this stuff. And at the moment, we're in a huge age of technological ferment, and media is changing, there's lots of new social media coming in. And I was wondering to what extent you're seeing that kind of creating new metaphors for engaging with this and new ways of understanding this kind of little bits of these sort of talking about.
That's a very interesting one. I'm trying to like figure out, because there's a lot of things I could say about that that don't really have that much to say directly about the imagination, because I think in many ways they actually erode a lot of the forces that I'm talking about, or at least transform them in ways that I can't really put my finger on, or it remains open. But the thing that's just popping up in my head that I think is interesting, and I guess you could talk about it somewhat in terms of social media, but I'm thinking about it more in terms of an information-saturated environment, and an environment in which any particular idea, concept, question, fascination, it will be reflected and intensified depending on your attention. So we're in the situation where I'm sitting there, you know, the archetypal image of I'm at my Google page, and where do I go? And I'm like, well, what did happen at 9/11? You know, and then a world opens, a portal opens into this realm where almost every assumption that I may or may not have can be reflected by some source of information or another. And this is true across the board: politics, science, you know, technology, medicine, and then particularly these realms of the, you know, of the supernatural, or particularly the conspiratorial, because there's a relationship, a profound relationship between the imagination and conspiracy. That the sense of the world coming together, things actually meaning something deeper than that, inevitably leads, if you take it far enough, to the sacred imagination. So I may begin as a JFK conspiracy freak, and it's all just about mobsters and Castro. If I just hang around there long enough and I have the right kind of temperament, it's going to start getting wiggy. It's going to start becoming supernatural. And so you can see these links between fantasies of, or whatever, ideas of, you know, the New World Order, or the, you know, Masonic banking conspiracies, and then they lead into the, you know, the lizard territory, or the, you know, whatever direction you might want to go. And so the way in which I think this information environment plays into this is that it provides a very kind of instantaneous feedback mechanism for the construction of realities that have a lot to do, that follow the logic of the imagination in some ways. But in terms of the psychological faculty of kind of engaging with images on a sort of individual level, or even on a collective level, it's not clear to me yet, because there seems to be something different happening in the nature of the group minds that arise in these feedback circuit loops of bits of data that become kind of collective and have their own dimension, but seem to be just kind of using us to make them to have that kind of metaphor. And from the inside, it's not clear to me how that plays into the imagination the way that I'm talking about, with the exception of this kind of conspiratorial feedback looping thing. I'll think about that, though. I think there's definitely some more interesting answers to that question. That's an interesting one. As for the first question about did something happen of a kind of crisis or some transition that produced the first encounter with her spirit guides, I don't know, but I don't think so particularly. And the decision to go back into that realm was more of a exploratory and kind of enthusiastic pursuit rather than something that seemed to be driven or reflecting kind of major transition or major, certainly major crisis. In terms of how she uses it, that was part of what was interesting. It's like, here's somebody who, whatever, give them 3 years and they'll, you know, if they wanted to, they would be clairvoyants. And they'd have clients who would come to them and have questions and they would do their thing for them and it would be constructed as such. And maybe that happens to a lot of people and then that kind of changes the experience. And here was someone who was kind of exploring it. And I think that initially what she found was that if other people were there, that spirits would come who would be for the other people, so that she would kind of be a conduit for a conversation. And sometimes it was sort of meaningless, and sometimes it seemed very meaningful and very relevant, which was in my experience. And there were some images that were coming through that had a great deal of meaning to me that she didn't know about, or that kind of stuff. But I'm not, you know, I don't make any claims based on that particularly. That said, I think what really ended up happening the most was that the realm was starting to teach her about how it worked. So it was almost like a recursive thing, where it was not like changing her life where she became more this way or like stopped eating meat or, you know, those kinds of transformations, so much as that the space of entering that other place began to take on more and more consistency, had more and more coherence, started to learn the ropes, and also recognizing that the messages that come out of it are very hard to interpret. They're sometimes meaningless, they sometimes are wrong, they, you know, sometimes are very powerful. And that's, you look at anybody who's gone, looks at those realms with open eyes, it's like, great stuff can come through, but they don't know, it's an interface. It's constantly melting and mutating. So I think it was really more of an initiation into a different kind of way of experiencing. But yeah, it's a really interesting question.
There are two authors that I don't know whether you've heard of that they touch most of what you talk about, both in slightly different ways. The first one's George Hanson, who wrote an extremely complicated book, Tricks of the Paranormal, where he deals with imagination, liminality, disinformation, conspiracies, you know, and sort of the ambiguous and in the sort of nature of paranormal phenomena, the imagination. That's basically what you're talking about. The second thing that comes to mind, particularly when you're Jacques Villiers' ideas of sort of UFO experiences being on Facebook taking the absurd and they sort of self-negate themselves, and his sort of idea that they might be some form of control system, although they sort of the controller again remains a sort of shadowy thing in the background. But I think they're both worth looking at, but treating very similar themes.
Yeah, I'm familiar with Valet's work, not the first one, though I think I've come across the name in a bibliography. But the question of control is very, very interesting. I mean, to my mind, the one of the fundamental questions or dimensions of modernity is control. Who is control? What is the nature of control? How do we externalize control in systems and technologies and institutions? How do we regain control as we feel like we're buffeted around by circumstances? Who's doing the control? The idea of a feedback loop between self and the world, or between technology and man, it's all about control systems. So it makes total sense to me that at the heart of some of these imaginal experiences, particularly the UFO is probably the best example, you confront directly the sort of issue of control. Where does control happen? It seems like it's a control mechanism in that what's on the surface is not what's actually really going on, but the minute you try to look at what's really going on, you seem to be falling into a system where you can't ground yourself, and you're aware of all of these control mechanisms that seem ambiguous or absurd or even contradictory, and yet it seems quite clear that they're there, so that there are even figures of control inside of the phenomena. So you have like the men in black are like part of the phenomena. So the people who come and like ask you about the experience later and give you the impression that you've like pissed off some really heavy characters and you better shut up or whatever, or give you false information, becomes part of it. I think that part of what that is a imaginal expression of the nature of information and the nature of how information and flows through different kinds of institutions, and secrecy produces these sort of gaps and blockages inside social reality that kind of manifest on this imaginal level. That's that historical dimension where the historical reality creates certain dynamics that go directly into this experience. And I think that that's part of what Jacques's talking about. But he's also leaving open the possibility that the whole, like, what is the nature of reality question involves kinds of control, which may not be controlled by an agent, but nature or the nature of cosmos, where there are certain kinds of glitches, because all control systems we know have glitches, have noise in the system, and that the UFO is almost like a bit of noise or a glitch in the construction of reality. So yeah, deep enigmas, dangerous one.
I enjoyed your talk very much. It was very eloquent and broad ranging. But until right at the end, I thought, surprisingly, that you're almost missing the point of the kind of contemporary study of analytical scholarship of the imagination, the imaginal, the alam vital, by a slight overemphasis on kind of phantasmic reductions, by emphasizing the ambiguity. I think obviously you have to be skeptical. And treat unconscious contents as Jung did, and inner empiricism, empirical, scientific, the imagination. I think so many people are engaged in the task, contemporary task, of maybe not using the kind of classical religious formulations of true and false in relation to the unconscious, but trying to formulate contemporary understandings of what is important, what has coherence, what has meaning, what has relevance to individuals and groups. What contents are egoic or non-egoic in a kind of continuum sense? What is the role of beauty and aesthetics and awesomeness? And I think particularly the kind of, the Sufi Islamic tradition of the relationship between dreams and events is very important. And that, I think, if one doesn't keep inner and outer worlds in a kind of dynamic correspondence, I think there is this danger, as I say, of kind of fantastic reductions of saying it's all a kettle. It's all wonderful, it's inspiring, and it'll all be illusionary, but I think that in a sense removes the task. I mean, if for instance you looked at the kind of the dream of Joseph and Pharaoh and the seven fat and the seven thin cows, both in the Quran and the Hebrew Bible, they're like the first climate change dreams, really. If you didn't have some concept of what was powerful and meaningful and future orientated in terms of reality, one would lose significance and a kind of grasp. I mean, I take all the hesitancies and ambiguities obviously on board. I mean, all the dream traditions, all state traditions have had that in them. But I think the human, as well as the scholarship task, is to actually move forward on these issues of relevance and coherence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, part of it is that I'm not, thankfully, an academic, and I mostly talk to people who are more directly involved in psychedelics, in spiritual practice, in the occult, in dreams. What's that?
You mean academics aren't?
Well, I just mean that I'm not. I actually think the academic task is almost the opposite. Is that you come after an enormous amount of skepticism, of reductionism inside human sciences, and that the task of maintaining the power and the transformative ability of images, of dreams, of experiences of beauty, it's like it's an enormous task to maintain a space for that and even claim and stand on that within a situation that's overwhelmingly, at least it sometimes appears to be overwhelmingly, outside of certain networks, reductionist and materialist and skeptical. And because of sort of where I come from, I'm more interested in sort of adding a sort of a bit of self-consciousness and a kind of recognition of the constructed nature of our experience to people who are like going on their ayahuasca visions. So in a way, it's where I'm kind of positioned in the discursive space. My desired effect is one in which I do not appear as skeptical as it seems like for you or for David that I
didn't
did,
get to
or whatever story. Reductionist, if you will. That for me, ambiguity and is itself a profound that it has the function of a theophany. That the ambiguity is part of that direct encounter. That you can talk about it in terms of beauty, or you could talk about it in terms of resonance or of a connection to a larger, to a whole. You could talk about it in terms of a connection to nature. But I also, and it's partly because I'm a creature of media or a creature of technology, that I really came to this stuff through understanding the history of media and the history of technology, and that's like in a way where I partly stand. So I'm interested in kind of maintaining the ambiguity of it as part of the larger message, not as a sort of excuse to dodge the full expression of the encounter, but that is part of the encounter itself. So if I was to do this talk again, I would make sure that I more seriously underlined the ecstatic dimension and the transformative dimension of these things, because they're incredibly important to my life and they've done this. And for me, when I talk about the initiation, that the initiation begins a process that you can't really go back to anymore.
I felt this about in your talk. There was this kind of, part of the argument was about ambiguity, but a lot of the content of what you were talking about was actually not from the position of ambiguity,
mm-hmm.
but of an awareness of theophany and transformation.
Mm-hmm.
So I did find this kind of interesting sort of
mm-hmm.
dialogue expressed in your talk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Which is good, that's fine.
Yes.
I'm going to have to kind of run extremely over time. It's a fantastic talk. I'd just like to say one little comment, if I may, sorry to interject, just about the kind of the pathologization of imagination. Certainly in my realm in parapsychology, talk about people's, they have these visionary experiences and they come to believe them, and it's kind of couched in terms of paranormal belief, and people try to understand that in terms of schizotypy and fantasy proneness as a kind of semi-pathological condition. And perhaps it might be more apt to kind of consider mundanity proneness as a semi-pathological condition. Anyway, just one last comment. Anything to say, Eric? I think we'll have to wrap it up there. We're going to have time for some more drinks, a little bit of hanging out, a little chat, and about half an hour, I believe. So thank you very much, everybody.
Thanks a lot.